Hello, I'm 1976's Teen Heartthrob of the Year, X, also known as Brushes of Doom. I'm here today on the World of Pencils podcast with Oda Paints. How's it going, brother?
Hello, good to be here. Doing great.
It's been a while, man, since we've spoken last time.
It has, what, over a year? Has it been that long?
It's been about 2 years.
No shit.
Yeah,
okay.
It's really been about...
Do I watch language?
Not at all.
Okay.
No, you're fine, man. We're all adults here, for the most part. At least I try to pretend to act like one.
Wild, then.
How have you been, man? It's been, I mean, you've been working your ass off. Last time I really talked to you, you and your lovely wife had been painting consistently, but you were working a lot on really big projects with photorealism and people, as far as like, you know, faces, hands, anatomy, so to speak. Now you guys are working on you're working on, you know, like rocks and stalagmites, stalactites, and other big words I didn't pay attention to in class.
Right.
What kind of made the shift change for you guys, or for you, I should say? I'm sorry.
Well, yeah, not only did we start really painting individually and trying to find our own voice, we realized that kind of finding ourselves would not just benefit our individual career, but when we do collaborate, it's going to benefit that as well. So if we can make ourselves individually stronger, that's good for us individually, and then it makes us stronger collaboratively. So we've been honing on that and not just focusing on that. Like you were saying, we were working on big time intensive projects where we do like one painting together and it would take a month.
Mm-hmm.
So now we've both grown so busy that we're learning more efficient ways to paint so that we can produce more. And we're working on multiple projects at once instead of one project together. We got a lot going on. So I'm grateful to be this busy. I never really saw myself being able to stay this steady with being able to create like this. So it's awesome.
That's good. Now, for anyone that doesn't know, Oda is the backstory to him and his wife all started off with a tattoo sketch that was perceived to be stolen, but wasn't. And do you want to give a little bit of backstory to anyone that doesn't know you?
Absolutely.
Please.
Let's see, where do we start? We got a little bit to talk, so I guess we can start from the beginning.
I was born in the year, the Lord of our year, 1923.
I'm from Florida, and I tattooed for 7 years. And I posted a photo online, a drawing on a hand that I wanted to tattoo. It was an owl on a hand. And I guess based off of the art nerd hashtag, my now wife, Kit King, came across that hashtag was searching that hashtag and came across my drawing. Come to find out she had posted an identical thing, thought that I copied her, but based off of the timestamp, realized that I posted mine 2 weeks prior, so there was no way that I could have copied her. And so it was like, shit, maybe he's going to think I copied him. And we just kind of started talking off of this, this crazy thing that we both drew identical things. And it wasn't, of course, there's lots of owls, but it was down to the T, like to the background, to the the bokeh that we tried to do. Bokeh is a out-of-focus blur that you get from a camera. So like that was drawn into the design, and everything was pretty identical. So it kind of started with this thing of who copied who, and then from there we were like, man, well, we both kind of dig our styles, and obviously they're similar since we can draw the same thing, and we started talking about collaborating. And while talking about collaborating, we fell in love from a great distance. From private and paint covered clothes. And we've been collaborating and working together ever since. It all happened relatively quickly. From the time that we met online, we spoke for about a year before even meeting. And then once we met, I had moved up here and we were married within another, say maybe 6 months.
Damn. Man, a man of ambition. That's why I admire that. I admire that greatly.
Yeah, it was like once we painted together, you know, I came up the first time and we kind of just sat in the studio and painted and did a collaborative piece, and it just clicked, and we knew that that's what we wanted to do. So everything made sense. Nothing felt forced. Everything was, it synced up and it felt right. And it has ever since.
That's rad, man. I think it's such a cool thing because I remember when you guys first told me about that, and from her point of view of how, like, you know, her sister and her were like ready to tear heads off. And then, you know, all of a sudden I've seen you both support each other over the past few years. And it's amazing to see what you guys have done with each other as far as apart, because it is very much the ultimate collaborative, like, ideal thing to have. Because, mm-hmm. you know, and I know, as well as many people listening, the idea of when you have artists, you know, that most of them are like, oh, you know, I would love to paint with somebody. And then they get someone in their space and all of a sudden they're like, God damn it, get out of my space. You know, I'm trying to paint this, I'm trying to do that. And so, you know, the culmination of both of you guys together working as a unit together, and then also working apart from each other, but still being able to give each other feedback and critique, you know, is very admirable, man. Now she, as well as yourself, were both you still tattoo, correct?
I do, yeah. We have a little private studio, and I do tattoo here and there. It's a tight circle of just referral. I don't advertise it, but I do still tattoo. I enjoy the medium. I feel better at tattooing than any other medium, so of course that's my comfort zone. I did that longer than anything. Kit taught me how to paint. So painting is still very new to me. Mm-hmm. Whereas tattooing is my comfort zone. I feel like I know what I'm doing with a machine in my hand. So I still enjoy that medium very much.
What is the biggest transition that you've felt over the years? Cause now we're in a position, I guess you could say point in time, but also industry wise that, a lot of tattoo artists are becoming fine artists, you know,
right.
as well as many fine artists are trying to become tattooers. And so you right. have this big mesh of like, we used it on one of the previous episodes of saying it's like a second coming of the Renaissance within this industry. Do you feel that, when you first started getting into where you're at now, do you feel it was harder to go from, you know, being an apprentice to a tattooer or being a tattooer to a painter, because there are two different dynamics from that? And like you said, you feel comfortable with the machine in your hand, but there are many people that, I mean, to anyone that doesn't know about tattooing, there are many artists out there that are great with a needle, are terrible with a brush, you know? So how did you kind of work with that? What was easier for you?
I don't know so much what is easier. I feel like I've had more years and more hours to hone the skills that it takes in tattooing. So I haven't put my 10,000 hours of painting in, you know, that's the rule of thumb, right? So, right. I feel as though I've definitely put that many hours in tattooing and I feel comfortable with it. To go from apprentice to tattooer, you know, you're kind of given the technical advice, you're given the health advice, how to stay clean and safe. And then whenever you're kind of released, I feel as though I grew more and more tattooing the more I got outside of where I learned. I was taught very well. Everything was explained to me, you know, to a T. But I felt as though I grew more when I started doing guest spots, and then I was on the convention circuit for a bit. And the more I was around my peers was really whenever I started to learn a lot myself and how I wanted to approach things. And I feel like the same thing has happened in painting. Like, I couldn't have had a better teacher than Kit. She paints very efficient, and she knows how to do things and how to do it without making mistakes, because she's done her 10,000 hours. She knows the mistakes. Therefore, I was able to fast track, and she, instead of really fucking up a lot and figuring out how not to do things, she told me from the get-go how to do it because it doesn't work or it does work. So I was able to fast-track painting, whereas tattooing, I went through the what doesn't work a lot. So I think that that could be the difference there. I guess I kind of got off.
No, you're right. You're right. Like you said, I'm sorry to interrupt, but it's like you said, it's not what's easier. It's what's more comfortable is not the right word, but you know what I'm trying to say, because there are two forms to it. And like messing up on a canvas, especially in oils, you can go right over it and try to figure it out. Messing up on skin, that's a whole nother deal. Putting in the 10,000 hours either way is its own difficulty in itself.
Yeah. It's dedication too. I feel like that's where I was getting at, was one of the benefits that since we have kind of tried to find our own voice, is it's that next step for me personally, that I'm kind of on my own, venture into seeing what works for me, not just on the technical side, because she's already taught me how technically, to paint, but it's more of that, that soul searching, you know, that kind of figuring things out on my own as far as the painting world goes. Where I did that in the tattoo world, I kind of got out there and spoke with peers, got tattooed, was on the circuit, did guest spots, and that's kind of where it helped me grow. So now in the painting world, focusing on my solo career, I'm kind of on that journey as well, and that definitely helps.
Nice. So when you started painting, moving forward, and you were diving into it, last time we spoke, you were still being like, oh yeah, you know, I'm still getting it here and there, and she, you know, she helps correct me and so forth. And now you've gone exponentially into these crazy detailed pieces. How do you feel like that has helped you as an artist? You know what I mean? Like when you look at working next to somebody who does a lot of giant pieces, a lot of rendering, do you feel like that's kind of like a second apprenticeship in a way?
Absolutely. I'm totally her apprentice. And still, like, every time we paint, like, she has to come over and tell me I'm doing something wrong. So it keeps me on my toes to make sure that I'm doing things right. But, and she's, like I said, a very efficient painter. So she paints quickly. And not in the sense that it's fast. She just knows how to do things right. And whereas if I make a mistake, I kind of backtrack a bit. So, like you were saying with painting, if you do something wrong, you can paint over it, but that takes time. So, you know, learning to paint without mistakes, you know, you're able to generate more work that way. So I'm still in that stage of, you know, I mess up enough, but it is paint. Like you said, I can go over it and take my time to render. But
so what kind of pushed you into the whole thing with more abstract and the art? Because the thing is as, I mean, hold on, let me rephrase that. Sorry. I'm trying to get my mind together on it, because it's also a thing of asking how to break apart from a joint venture, so to speak. Because you and Kit both do phenomenal work, but then you guys have kind of went on your own way just because for your personal careers. And you've seen like this major transition with her art, where she was doing a lot of palette knife stuff, a lot of, you know, different shades of white and just very, very fine art. And then you went off and you went on to do a lot of these rock pieces, a lot of like earth theme pieces that are beautiful, but it's completely different from where you both are at 2 years ago. So what kind of pushed that transition, at least for yourself?
I think it's all about the mental journey for both of us. Like if you see, kind of in both of our careers, but more so her, since she's been doing this, you know, a little bit longer, that we only work on things in that field for so long. And then, we kind of look for more. So for a little bit there, we were collaborating and then doing these hyper-realistic figures, portraits, eyes, things of that nature. And then it wasn't long before we tried other things. And then, yeah, in our personal career, she's using a lot of textures and palette knives. I'm still drawn to fully rendering something. I'm trying to get more about the texture, more about implied details, trying to improve palette knife works and just trying to make something look a certain way without sitting there and tiny rendering it. I'd like for one stroke to give the same impression as if I had just, spent an hour in a space the size of a dime. So I think it's more about constantly being on that journey to find not just what we enjoy to paint, but growing as an artist. So it's constantly changing. I'm not sure if that kind of answered the question of where that of what you were saying there or not.
No, you're fine, man. Because you guys have definitely been in a lot more upscale galleries. You've been talking to a lot of artists, which, I mean, the Instagram community as well as just in general the art community are two real big things that you guys, you know people and people love your work, you love their work. And so having that influence, like you said, it's like looking at yourself at 13 to 18, 18 to 20, 20 to 25, 25 to 30. And once you hit that 30, you start looking back at every single age you were at and you're like, God, that was like a whole different person. That was a whole different me. And right. Where you guys are at or where you're at personally, you're meeting all these different influences that are helping you shape and grow as an artist that in 20 years, you're going to look back and be like, huh, yeah, I remember doing that. Or, oh yeah, that was something for the bit.
Yeah, exactly.
So what are you currently working on right now?
Everything is really about, I have a solo, my first solo coming up.
Congratulations.
Thank you. It's super exciting. It's September 9th, going to be at Raison Gallery in the Hamptons, yeah. New York.
Jason.
Yeah, I know. him and Kate are great and loved that I got this opportunity, and everything is really focused on those works right now. So I've been a little bit absent from social media, trying to show little snippets here and there. But I'm keeping everything, kind of hush hush until it gets a little bit closer. So, I'm not posting as much, but definitely working more than ever, and everything is going toward that right now. I have a lot of new, different things going to be happening for it. So I'm excited that as it gets closer, I'll be able to share a little bit more. But like my work, it is based off Earth. It is going to be about just the environment. I want to focus my efforts and energies toward bringing awareness to it. I feel like in art, figures, portraits, faces, like that is when you're born as a child, like the first thing you see is a face. It's the most recognizable thing. So I feel like in art, it's recognizable, it's accepted, and people get excited about figurative portraiture type work. And I want people to get that excited about Earth. It's been here a long time. And I feel like that it's overlooked a lot. Just something as basic as a stone, that most people would find boring per se. If I can do it on a scale and put it in a certain composition that makes it beautiful and makes people want to stop and look at it and even hang it in their home, then that's my purpose for the show. I'm going to be doing not just the dazzly kind of gems that I was doing, but more so, I guess you could call it basic type imagery, just because I find beauty in that. Something as simple as the ground, dirt, stones, rocks. It doesn't have to have these facets and jewel type things to it. I just want to bring awareness to the beauty that is Earth, and hopefully get people on board with that.
Nice. Let's talk about the gallery stuff.
Okay.
For most people that don't know how galleries work, from a tattoo point of view, you know, being a tattoo artist coming into the fine art world, what were some of the experiences you've kind of gone through? Because a shout out to Jason and Kate over at Racing Gallery. I mean, genuinely good people. I love Kate. I love Jason, but like they are, Jason is an art enthusiast that cares about the artist, you know? And with that being said, when he puts on shows, he cares about what you want to do. And then you hear other art galleries that unfortunately have like horror stories and it's and it's like a popularity contest of like, well, if I just get this person in here, get their stuff in here, then everyone will come to my gallery. I make money and then I'll figure the rest out later. So, what was like your introduction to galleries when you first started to move into painting, and what are some of the most interesting things that you've come across since then?
I don't want to talk too much horror story.
That's okay.
But I will say that it was a culture shock, I guess you could say. I knew nothing about it. Nothing about galleries, nothing really about fine art. You know, I had painted a little watercolor type stuff. I had done a little, maybe a couple acrylic things, but really didn't know anything about the world. And I probably should have read a little bit more and educated myself getting into it. Mm-hmm. 'Cause I could have avoided, I don't know about embarrassing moments, but just uneducated moments. You know, I feel like I could have gone in a little more prepped for it. Everything down to packaging a piece of art, you know, like over the last couple of years, I really know that how to go the distance of what makes something good from how it's framed, how it's, you know, the different materials and what you use, going into it kind of uneducated. Certain materials could be not quite as high quality. And the more you get into it, the more you realize that that matters. Mm-hmm. So now I really take pride in what we paint on, how it's framed, how it's packaged, how it arrives at the gallery, how it's shown once it's there. To even how it's presented on a social media platform. So over the last little bit, the education that went into learning about the fine art world, is, like I said, kind of a bit of a culture shock. Started to read a little bit more about the history of art. I did not go to school for it. So there's kind of I'm torn in between those that did go to school versus the self-taught. I feel like there's benefits to both, but the education that you can learn from it,
yeah,
I do see the purpose in that now, because it took reading, it took effort, it took knowledge to learn that stuff, aside from just the technical aspect of learning how to do something. Like learning how to do something is just done with repetition, but the background, the stuff that you don't see, the stuff that you should know, it takes effort.
Yeah, the foundation, as you were saying. And I genuinely believe that there are a lot of fine artists, and by fine artists I mean somebody, like, I don't want people to categorize when I mention that, even though I know I'm not using it in the correct way. It's not somebody who is just doing extreme fine art. To me, in this sense of the conversation, fine art is somebody who is taking art and doing it outside of the realm. Let's just put them and categorize them outside of tattooing. And then tattooing, obviously, being where they're at. And we've seen tattoo gallery shows. We've seen all this stuff. And I think both sides tend to forget or aren't even aware of the fact that there are beautiful, beautiful works from some of these people who tattoo and genuinely have great composition, have good clean work and all this stuff. And then they paint and they're staring at every single fine artist, the quotes around the fine artist, and thinking to themselves, fuck, I wish that could be me. Like, they feel intimidated by somebody who is a little bit more educated, probably understands things that most of us are self-taught. You know, even if you are going to college, I mean, at some point or another, you taught yourself something and you're going to learn more. And I think a lot of the fine artists, quote again, look at some of the more tattoo-based people or in that category of those people, and they like the freedom of it. They like the freedom and the travel and the popularity of what's going on sometimes. But there is so much knowledge from both areas that are intrigued. I sometimes, when I look at your guys' work or, you know, Jason's gallery or Kate or any of these other people that I am fortunate enough to be around sometimes, and I think to myself, like, fuck, I read a lot because I'm interested, but like you said, I don't want to seem stupid because I'm trying to learn, and the worst possible thing for me to do is to be like, oh yeah, that's a great piece right there. It's got very avant-garde there. What the fuck are you talking about?
Right.
So I think a lot of people don't realize how much both sides are intrigued by each other, but also intimidated. So it's great seeing you because you have that transition, as well as, like you're saying, you know, without naming galleries or naming stuff, like there's always something to learn from it. There's always something that you're going to gather. But the biggest thing is, I think most of us as artists or people that are intrigued by artistic ability want to automatically, they see you guys painting and the level you're at and being like, I want to do that right now. And they can achieve it. You know, like you said, over enough practice, you can do anything. But then it gets down to the fundamentals and they're like, man, I should have started from the beginning. And we find a lot of artists who are very talented and very good at execution, but have no foundation.
Right, right.
You know, and most of us tend to go back to those roots and relearn everything we possibly can.
Yeah.
How do you feel that that's worked with you?
I feel like that's kind of the boat I'm in. I feel like the more I dive into the art world, the more I want to step back and learn. Because yeah, you can put the time in and figure out how to technically do something well. I don't want to say anybody can do it, but I feel like anybody can. Like if you practice enough, you know, you can make something look a certain way. But the fundamentals of it, like, when you look at something and ask yourself, why do you like this? Why is this good, but this is not? To me, that's the fundamentals. And that's kind of finding out who you are as an artist. And when you view somebody else's work, what you see in it. There's a sculptor who's one of my favorite sculptors, and it's Isamu Noguchi. And I came across him not too long ago, but Kit was asking me why I like his work, and I was embarrassed to say that I didn't know why. And I was just drawn to it. But I feel like that's kind of, there's an ignorance to it. Like, if you can't tell yourself why, then you need to educate yourself on it. I need to figure out what it is about that for me is good, for me works. And that's an education thing. It kind of makes you take a step back and really study something, really figure it out, because if you can find that kind of stuff out, then it's going to help improve your own work, which is why when I approach something that I work on now, I try to ask myself those things. What about this do I want to convey and let the viewer kind of feel that as well? So yeah, that's some educating that I need to do for myself, as far as, you know, going back to the basics and really just asking myself why and how something works and something feels good to look at. So.
There's a lot of people who genuinely feel like I've never been able to relate to artists that are like, I saw the most beautiful sunset, so I had to paint my feelings, which I'm not making fun of. It's just like, I've heard people do that and I'm like, that's cool. But I felt like an asshole. Because I'd look at a sunset and I'm like, yeah, that's cool. I mean, like, it doesn't make me want to paint, you know? I felt like, if anyone's seen The Boondocks, I feel like that stink meter guy where just some people aren't always happy. I see a sunset, I'm all, this is some shit up old bullshit. You know, like, I just, I don't know. Like, it always kind of threw me off. And then I had met David Chaffetz, you know, and I've brought him up quite a few times, but the dude is genuinely such a cool dude. And he had said something that always stuck in my head, which was the idea of, he goes, I can't, you know, I do really fine art, you know, I do this stuff, but I'll watch Mad Max. And for some reason they're in the desert, you know, there's a guy playing guitar from bungee cords. And he goes, I just see a color. And I'm like, you know what? I like that color. I'm going to go paint it. So the ability to be inspired by something, I think, also shifts as well, because when you first start, a lot of people like to do what they visually like to see. Then you see people graduate to the idea of sharing something that's maybe personal to them, or they share a story or something of awareness. Blake Newbert was, I believe, on our first episode, and he's the guy who scrapes away all the paintings and does other beautiful work as well. But he was talking about him, Emilio, I can't ever say his last name, Valbia.
Right.
You know what I'm talking about. But they were going back and forth, and, you know, he just didn't know what he wanted to paint. And he said it himself. It's like he got to a point where this is how he felt, what we see, what we read, you know, as far as a society. And this is the story behind it. I guess for you, I should be doing it the other way. But he goes, you know, this is the story of Michael Jackson and what we saw him as. This is the terrible stuff that happened to him that probably led to somebody who was probably very troubled. So right. The storytelling, the idea of sharing a message, I think is also part of that idea of being educated. You know, when you're a kid and you're in kindergarten, you're going to take a crayon and you're going to draw a sun and a smiley face and you playing in the grass because you think it's, you know, that's cool. I can draw that. And right. as you become older, you start finding different things that intrigue you that you want to share with people. And I think that's where you're going with what you're saying. It's like, it's nice because sometimes you just like certain things, you know. You see my nerd collection. I'm really intrigued by these sculptors. You know, mm-hmm. I follow them, and it's just really interesting that they sculpt. I'm just very lucky they sculpt very nerdy things. And right. But, you know, like you said, sometimes you don't know why you like something. Other mm-hmm. times it gradually turns into something where you're like, you know what, this is how I feel about something, and I'm going to paint about it and tell a story, you mm-hmm. know, essentially in one panel.
Indeed.
Sorry.
No. I totally agree with that. And yeah, that I guess with my recent paintings of earth, stones, minerals, gems, things like that, that is that thing that's something that I find beauty in, I want to paint. And then it's just fingers crossed that other people are on board with it. Mm-hmm. But that's the thing, like, there's going to be people that maybe don't see it, and the people that see it and like it but don't know why. But I guess for me as an artist, I would like to not so much have people like it mm. as much as question it, kind of thing. So maybe they look at something I painted and I don't know. It might not be for them. They might not, quote unquote, like it. But if they think about it and it makes them wonder what it is about it that raises a question, like, to me, that's just as good if they were to say that's the most beautiful thing they've ever seen. Because I think that that's important for me is raising the question, raising awareness for what it is that the subject matter that I'm painting is. Because it's art, it's subjective. People are going to like it, people are going to hate it. But I kind of like the idea that maybe somebody would question it. So
where do you see yourself in the next few years? I mean, you have the earth theme going on right now, and this is something you'd like to bring awareness to. Is it just kind of like no pun intended, but like a seasonal thing, you know, maybe sticking to the environment, but a different element? Or is it just kind of something that you're very captivated in the moment? Because some artists do follow seasons of emotion as to where other artists follow themes, you know, and neither one is right or wrong. It's just the way people work. Where are you going?
I see myself sticking with the elements, earth, you know, even implementing water and fire. to speak a little bit about some of my works for the solo. I'm really getting into the life of Earth, which to me is volcanic, you know, volcanoes. I love that, you know, a planet is alive if it has volcanoes, if it can breathe in that sense. To me, that's Earth's life. So I'm going to touch on that a bit, which leads me to sculpting. My solo show will have quite a few sculpted works. So where do I see myself in the next 5 years? I see myself more hands-on with builds and sculpts versus painting. I am really drawn to a lot of sculptors right now. Like I said, Osamu Noguchi, big influence for me. And I'd like to see myself do more of that kind of sculpted hands-on work. I love to build. So anything that involves kind of a hands-on kind of thing.
You are a handyman. Like you, whether it's around the house or whether it's building frames and everything, that's an awesome thing to hear, because you are very much a hands-on guy. If anyone follows you on Instagram or Facebook or so forth, you're always working on something on top of painting.
Yeah. That's another thing that's kind of behind the scenes right now. Kit and I, our collaborative works have kind of gone more toward builds and design. So we have things that are kind of hush-hush right now until we get enough and we're going to release it all. And so that's kind of aside from painting and both of our solos that we have coming up. Whenever we work together, that's going on as well. So there's some really exciting things in the works with us collaboratively. And it comes down to, hands-on and design. We like trying to create something that's functional, but is also rooted in design and art. So we're trying to kind of bridge those and bring that together in the things that we're currently working on the aside from our already busy schedule of paintings and for shows and whatnot.
Do you work from photo reference, or do you try to look up like National Geographic videos? Because with having such a busy schedule, I know you don't travel as much as you probably both would like, but I mean, I'm assuming that you would love to go to like Hawaii or some of these places where it would, you know, you could get literal experience and photo reference. How do you really work around that? Because I know some artists, looking at one of the photos you have here right now that we'll put up on the live feed, but you're working from a photo reference and it's on your iPad, which that's a pretty sweet stand. I got to ask you later what you're using, but there's some artists where Pam, I can't remember her name, but her name's Pam W22, I believe. Sweet woman, a beautiful oil painter. But she does say that, you know, she's a little bit more old school before, you know, iPads and phone, the cell phone and stuff. And she says when you work from a something with a glossy surface or an illuminated surface, you genuinely tend to over-exaggerate colors because you can't match those colors. Yet I'm looking at your work, and of course, you know, I work from it as well as I've met many other artists that work from a illuminated screen or a digital photo. And I mean, it's pretty goddamn on point to me, you know. Do you feel that, I mean, first off, what do you work from? And second of all, I'm sorry, what do you prefer to work from? And second of all, what are your feelings about live reference versus digital reference?
When I do work from reference, it's from the iPad. I think the piece that you're speaking of that could be pulled up right now that I had sent you, that was my own photography. The places that I do go to get reference, you're right, I don't travel anymore. I would love to go to Hawaii or Iceland and be firsthand at a volcano or even some kind of, mine or quarry, just get some more photos of Earth itself. But that photo was taken from a museum. So whenever I do go, I like to go to the local Museum of nature, the Nature Museum, mm-hmm. Here in Ottawa. And I take a lot of photo reference myself from there. So that piece was my own photo reference. Otherwise, I like to watch videos and even screen cap from videos. So that way it's a little bit more of an organic kind of feel versus somebody else's, you know, frozen snapshot that they spent time to do.
Right.
Also, if it does get close to my reference, great, but I don't try to adhere to that so much.
Yeah. Emulate what you're looking at.
Yeah. One, because it's frustrating if I don't achieve it. Like I was working on something a while ago and it really wasn't what I was going for, but it worked. And I was more frustrated that, yeah, this maybe it looks cool. Maybe it does, but it's not what I was hoping to achieve. So I was frustrated with myself. I felt like I didn't do what I had set out to do, whether or not the outcome was good. So I feel like I have a little bit more freedom if I allow myself to just paint or just sculpt and create, and not try to emulate what I see, because then it takes the frustration of, did I get it right? Did I nail it? You know, and that's also something that I feel a freedom from as far as painting these earth elements, that there's room for interpretation. I'm not trying to pick up someone's certain skin tone or features of their nose and ears and whatnot. Like, I can be a little different. No one knows that this mountain looks like this. You right. know, I don't have to make it the same. So there's a little bit of freedom in that.
Impressionism, in a way.
Yeah, yeah. It allows me to, you know, be free, play around, but also not have that stress of trying to nail the reference, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
A lot of the reference that I did take myself is taken in the dark. I don't have the opportunity to ask the museum if I can have a little one-on-one photo shoot with these pieces. So it's with a lot of people around and in a dark case with a tiny little light that has a lot of reflective surfaces, and I'm trying to get a shot. So I kind of got to make up a little bit of it, but I do prefer to see something to work from, and not base everything off my imagination alone. But I like a little bit of both. I like working from a reference and then allowing my imagination to kind of run from there.
Well, yeah, because it's very much like a muscle. You know, you're allowing your brain to work out the idea of where lighting and refractions happen, and, you know, opaque colors versus translucent, and having that to build on top, I think slowly starts getting you in that that mindset of being able to just do everything from memory. You know,
right.
the trickiest thing I've ever heard was on another podcast. I was talking to somebody about, they were saying, you know, well, I don't really respect anybody who does art, nothing personal. I mean, that's literally what they said. I'm like, all right, cool. I go see where this goes. And they were saying, you know, the idea of they don't like people who do comic book stuff because it's not their character. They're forever doing someone else's work. As to where I had another guest, where they were speaking as a comic book artist and said, you know, I respect fine art for what it is, but, you know, there is no reference for two aliens who don't exist to right. have a full 360 understanding of them, their anatomy, their surroundings, their planet. You know, you have to be able to draw 400 little paintings, little panels of this entire story and be able to make up with it. And I said, well, how did you build that up over the years? And he goes, to be honest, it was doing fine art. He goes, mm-hmm. I learned very much on how to give the impression that this was a little bit, I would exaggerate this photo I had, or I would do this and that, and being able to build those small little nerves to be able to be like, all right, well, now, as you said, you like pulling from both, but one day if that mountain, you want to Bob Ross it and be like, yeah, of course there's snow on this side. Check this out. Swipe. You know right. what I mean? So definitely comes with the 10,000 hours.
It does. I'm envious of those people that can do that, though. Like you said, there's no alien reference. Like those guys that can create that stuff in their minds. I'm envious of it.
What's something that you genuinely you admire now being around a lot more artists in the, like, the painter community, or back again to the quote unquote fine artists. What is something that, I don't want to say Emmy, that's the wrong word, but like, what's something that you really admire and, are drawn to that you probably weren't before? Cause I know for myself, the biggest thing I'm really interested in is the idea of glazing backgrounds. You see a lot of these older, like almost Rembrandtish type of paint styles, or Sargent, and it looks like you can really just jump in there, and you find it's like, you know, two dozen layers of glaze and like an off green, you know.
Right.
So what's something for you?
Those that can paint loosely, I'm so drawn to that, envious of it, wishing that I could. Like, to me, rendering is my comfort zone, but I almost feel like anybody with enough practice can. So that's where I'm trying to grow. I'm trying to paint a little looser and give the effect that something is detailed without detail. I feel like I like to see those painters that can palette knife and make detail with just a stroke, like where they place it, how they put the dark and light together to draw your eye to it. Like, just these things that, to me, I'll call a loose painting. I don't know if that's the right way to say it, but to me, using less strokes and less rendering, but still generating the same effect, is where I wish I was that kind of painter. You mentioned David earlier. His paintings, like, he can make a fucking hammer the most badass looking thing ever. Like, it's a hammer. That's not a particularly interesting thing.
It's not even Thor's.
Right, exactly. But he makes it look so fucking good, you know?
Yeah.
And it's how he paints it. So I'm totally drawn to that, and how somebody is able to do it. I can't paint that way yet. I would like to. So the more I, you know, am in the art world, seeing other artists do things like that, it definitely, it drives me. It makes me want to get better, want to grow from fully rendering something. I want to kind of dabble in everything and find out what kind of artist I am. And those kind of artists make me want to, get better. So
a little shout out to David and his online lessons. David Chaffetz, for anyone that does know his work or doesn't know his work, at David Chaffetz, he does online classes now. And because you don't personally travel as much, just because you're so busy, have you ever thought about doing like online education? There's, you know, places like Schoolism and so forth. Or are you someone that has to be kind of hands-on with somebody in the studio? Because I do like online education. I've tried Schoolism. I've tried, you know, a few other artists that I've been able to talk to over the podcast and over the years. But nothing beats being in a physical setting where you can look at their brush. You can look at what they're doing. You know, Sean Cheatham's a perfect example of when he moves his brush around, he shapes it in the paint to make that stroke, you know? And if you're watching from a screen, 9 times out of 10, you're looking at the painting, you're not looking at the application.
Right.
You know, are you more of a person are you more of someone who would like to be in person and watch somebody paint? Are you somebody that could definitely go with the online touch?
If I was to go that route, like, I guess, there's benefits to it. I would prefer to see it in person, but I'm nervous and awkward like I am right now. So there's the side that I would just rather see it on a screen.
Right.
Whereas I'd be very nervous in person, but I feel like I'd learn better that way. So I'm torn. If I was to do that, you know, there's the side of me that's would just prefer a screen so I can stay in my home and, you know, if I get jittery and chatty, then I'm not in front of a bunch of people. But I do like the closeness and the realness of being there in person, being able to watch Kit paint greatly improves me being able to paint. Like being right next to her and seeing how she does something directly affects how I paint, you know, whereas whenever we first met, we would Skype and FaceTime and we would draw together. And it's one thing to kind of paint together that way, but to be in person, it's much different. It's much better. So I do see the benefit of a, you know, classes that way versus online, but it could go either way. Like, if I was to take a class now, I'd probably prefer online since it's hard for me to be.
It's more convenient.
Yeah.
Let's talk about the sculpting a little bit. I think that's the one thing that intrigues a lot of people, that it seems like, I mean, it is very hard. I mean, but it's one of those things that some people tend to feel like it's unattainable because it's a whole set of skills. Mm-hmm. And I mean, watching a lot of head sculptors or figures that I collect, you know, they show you the process of anatomy. They show you the process of exaggeration and how all this works. I'm also a giant Leica Studios nerd. So stuff like Kubo or Coraline, Paranorman, all these little characters they make are just outstanding. But the thing that I really do admire is this guy named Joe, I think it's Andamaro or something like that. He's a sculptor for Disney, I believe. But he puts out a lot of characters, and he says, you know, to become a better painter, I became a sculptor. Because okay. Yeah, 'cause from every point and angle, I had to understand how anatomy worked. And he goes, right. I didn't want to draw 1,500 hands a day to learn hands. I sculpted 1,500 hands and had no problem to learn hands. So when I paint them, I think about planes. I think about dynamic. I think about depth. Do you feel that when you're getting into sculpting, it helps you with painting? Or is it something, like you said, like you kind of want to move more to hands-on stuff? Is it just because sculpting is just a whole physical medium where you have to delve into it, you know, more than a two-dimensional space?
I think that's interesting. I think my brain works better three-dimensionally. Mm-hmm. Kit and I talk about this all the time. Like even if we were to, whenever we sit down to design something, we do things in our house a lot different rooms to redesign the room and whatnot. And whenever we sit down to sketch it out, I'm all about perspective. I'll draw it, you know, perspectively, three-dimensionally, how it's going to look if we kind of mock up how we're going to do a bench or whatnot. Like to me, it's, I see it dimensionally. And so for me sculpting, that is the hands-on experience of how I see it. So to paint three-dimensionally, to make something look three-dimensional on a two-dimensional surface, I have to train my brain to do that. Whereas sculpting is a little bit, has a more natural feel, just because I think that's how I'm wired. So it's easier for me to see this block of something and then sculpt it into what I want it to look like versus having a flat surface and making my mind push the paint around to give it the effect that it's dimensional. So I don't know if it's so much, I could definitely see to be a better painter, you sculpt because you kind of understand moving around the object. When Kit's teaching me how to paint, that's one thing she says is that, you know, if you're painting this nose, you're not just painting the nose. You're on this journey. This paintbrush is on a journey and it's got to fall around this roundness. It's got to go into this curve and crevice. And so you're thinking that way. Mm-hmm. So I can definitely see how sculpting would help you in that thought process. For me, that thought process of sculpting is already there. So I feel more comfortable doing that, which is why like you said, where do I see myself in 5 years? I see myself doing that more. It is more comfortable for me to sculpt and hands-on build something three-dimensional than to do something two-dimensionally. So
any kind of specific things you want to sculpt? I mean, since you're kind of more intrigued by the idea of earth and elements, would you be trying to sculpt and recreate Earth-like images, or not images, but I guess you say objects, or would you try to even it out between like anatomical things and.
I guess a little bit of both. I like shapes. I like how, to me, I'm drawn to roundness. Kitz even said that, whether I'm drawing, painting, or sculpting something, I have this roundness that comes out. Whereas, like, she's very drawn to sharp lines. So I guess there's this natural roundness that I enjoy, or that just comes out in how I draw and create. So form is really first for me and what I'd like to do. And right now I am kind of playing with things that exist on Earth that I can draw from reference and try to recreate. But as I do it more and more, I want to loosen from that and just kind of create form that I enjoy based off of these earth elements, whether it's implementing wood or stone and creating my own shape from there, or trying to implement something that Earth has already made. I see myself doing a little bit of everything as long as it's based around these elements. So.
If you could work with one sculptor, as far as on a future project, who would it be and for what reason?
I don't know contemporary names very well. I do follow a lot of people that I enjoy, but I don't really stick to names. So if there's people out there that I admire or are inspired by, I'm sorry that I can't think of who they are. Aside from Osamu Noguchi, who's dead, I would love to just see some of his works in person, but I don't know about working with other people because I honestly don't know much about them. It's one thing to flip through and see what you like on social media, but I don't get too involved with who they are so much, or able to remember their names. So I don't really know, but there's definitely a bunch that I follow that I am inspired by.
If you could work on a dream project, sculpting wise, what would it be?
If I could work on a what?
Dream project. Like something, even if, I mean, even now, you know what I mean? Because obviously your dreams and wants and aspirations are different in the next few years, even a few months, but something right now that you would love to do.
I'd love to create large. Like I still, I don't know, working with somebody is strange, except for when it comes to my wife. Like I still love working with her. So really that's still my dream. I would love to create with her more and going big. Our house is small. Our studio is on the small side. Like I don't really, I guess that's relative, but, she's smiling at me right now.
I
She's
say
paying her
hi.
ass off, but she came out to smile.
I'll say hi.
But yeah, we want more space to do big stuff. So I guess for me, a dream project would be having the ability to go large and place that somewhere. It's one thing to create it, but it's also another thing to put that somewhere for people to see. So for me, the dream would be the opportunity to go large and then have that in an area where people can view it.
Nice. As sorry, I have to readjust over here. With your paintings and with the whole gallery thing, I know you're very proud and you're excited for this solo show. This is gonna be your very first one. Anything that you kind of have a fear of? Because I know there are a few
Oh
people
my God.
that contact the World of Pencils email, as well as the Brushes of Doom one, and. You know, they love to hear from the artists because they have this conceptualization that you guys are like impenetrable, you know, that you just do it and you and Kit walk out with just a paintbrush and a holster and like, all right, art everywhere, you know. But they like to hear certain things that maybe that go through your head when you're physically painting or doing gallery shows, because when they approach those obstacle points, they know that they're not the only ones that are going through it. Are there any actual fears you have with preparing for a show? Because you also are not only busy with doing the private stuff, you also have commissions, correct? Mm-hmm.
commissions are doing less and less of them, just so we can focus on the things that we need to do for these shows and kind of doing what we want to do. Not so much in that it's an ego thing, like I want to do what I want to do because I want to do it. It's more to get to somewhere. You have to do these things that you want to do to show people that that's where you want to go. So I'm more in the, I'm trying to use the solo opportunity to really kind of show who I want to be and what I can do. Mm-hmm. So there's the fear that people aren't on board with it. I'm terrified that no one's going to show up, that, you know, I won't sell anything. I don't really care about selling anything as much as I do as I want there to be people on board with it, you know. Sales are great, commissions are great, this is our job, so it's how we generate income. But whether I made money with it or not, I still want to do it. Like, I'm drawn to creating. Mm-hmm. So there's always the fear of people not caring about it, you know. Yeah. Whether or not they can purchase it is one thing, but I'd love for people to just be able to enjoy it and show up and tell me what they think about it. Even if it's a negative response, you know, I want that interaction. I don't really get out and go to the shows often, so I am going to be at my solo. It's going to be scary, not just to be there talking to people about my own work, but it'll be scary to see the outcome, the responses. So there's definitely, I feel like there's more fear than there is the other end of the spectrum of it, but it's what you got to do. I guess you got to put yourself out there if you want to see anything come from it. So it's just one of the things that I got to do.
That's good though. I mean, everybody that goes through their own, through a solo show or being part of a gallery show, is plagued by fear. And I think that's a big thing that a lot of people don't talk about is, you know, I was fortunate to be part of my very first, well, part of a, my very first show I was asked to paint something for, which was Hope Gallery ran by Joe Capobianco. And it was an honor, but at the same time, it was like, there's all these amazing artists that are there. And here's my ass doing this Krampus piece. And I was really nervous. And you never really think about how, you know, people are proud to have their artwork, or they may have the confidence. But I think that fear keeps you grounded. I think that fear, when you have it and you're around other people, keeps you a little bit more humble, because in that moment, you do recognize talent. You do recognize work, and you still have that appreciation. You're hoping that yours is sufficient enough to match to the other ones without worrying about being, you know, as good as someone else. You just want yours to be received well. So to hear that is very comforting, because, I mean, let's be honest, you and, you know, Kit, but speaking about you, you're a phenomenal painter, man. Whether you want to take the compliment or not, you very much are. And, you know, I've talked to you on and off mic here and there over the past 2 years, and you're a genuinely kind guy. You know, you're a good dude, and you care about stuff. You care about the education aspect of it, which is coming from somebody who cares about education, you know, and all this stuff. It's humbling to see that you're getting to this point where you're reaching higher circles. You're reaching more artists and more people. And now you have this visual medium as far as Instagram and Facebook and all these things, as well as we all do. But I mean, like, you have this point where you are reaching people that admire your work, contemporaries, peers, and admirers in general. And to be able to hear that you're, you know, climbing this ladder internally and externally, and still have a level head about it, is a very comforting thing. Because we've all met those artists where, like, you're like, oh man, that's a great painting. Painting? This is the life's work of my blood. And you're like, oh, that's cool, dude. Yeah, it's nice. Yeah, but I know this one's probably gonna be a little bit shorter than the rest of them, but I know you have to get back to work soon enough. But is there anything that you want to kind of cover as far as painting, sculpting, or anything for people out there that are interested? Or maybe some questions you've gotten over the years that you feel you'd like to answer.
I don't know, that's hard. Like, I get questions all the time. I try to answer them as I get them. So I try to be
Punctual.
personable as much as I can. If somebody has a question, I generally like to answer it. And I try not to let anything slip by. But just to also to touch on, thank you for the compliments.
Oh, that's the
I
truth.
still don't think I'm very good, so
Well, you paint a whole lot better than I do, so I mean,
that's subjective and relative. Like, who's to say that? So
I am. I'm the guy painting.
yeah, I'm not sure. Let me think if there's maybe something that I
Yeah.
could cover.
Well, while you think about that, let me cover something as you think about something to cover. The great thing about Corey and with Kit is, like, the best way I've ever heard you guys being described, when I first heard about you, from Trekle and Courtney over there, as well as from people through Instagram that had admired your work, was just like, always kind compliments, always people that were willing to talk and teach and learn. And then there was this one person who described you guys as the Americans' Dabs Mila. And I was like, oh, that's a very interesting relation to, but the only reason why is because it's a couple that works together very
Right.
well. And if anyone's talked to Dabs Mila, which it's, I mean, they're so busy, it's hard to talk to them just as much as it's you guys. I think the best thing that I've ever learned out of seeing, I don't want to say power couples because you guys are your own people and your own entity, but as a quote unquote power couple, it's amazing to see two like-minded people who are hungry for art, who are hungry to learn more and never afraid to be content. The worst thing in the world, in my opinion, because I'm guilty of this every fucking time, I paint something or I sketch something and it actually comes out a little better than I thought it was, and I'm like, all right, yeah, that's all me right there. And
Right.
you stare at it, and you kind of you revel in it for at least a good hour or a day or so. And when that happens, a lot of people feel that every single piece needs to be a masterpiece, but because they see people like yourselves who are working your asses off 24/7 doing things, but not realizing that before you had reached that masterpiece, you were doing those 10,000 hours of multiple sketches. The second you finish one, you're like, all right, I did it. Now on to the next one. So perpetually always working in a motion of like, okay, got to get this done, do the best I can, and move and learn. And now seeing you guys older, wiser, and more talented, you're definitely pushing the idea of expression. And that's a great thing to see. You're learning, you're encouraging people to learn, you're encouraging people to try new things. Everybody for a while was trying to do portraits, and everybody was doing, surrealism. And there's nothing wrong with that, nothing at all. But there are certain catalysts in the artistic community, I feel, that have a pull. And you guys, to me, are definitely some of those people that when you do something new, it allows other people who look up to you to be like, huh, maybe I should try something like that. And that invents a whole nother realm of creativity. So to see you guys not only together and apart, work together as a giant, just one big art nerd team, you know what I mean? It's also great to see that over the years, you literally inspire people to be like, you know what? This is kind of weird, but check it out. And like you said, it's not for everybody, but there are those people that go to it. And even myself, like, I've never thought of, looking at art the way Kit does or the way you do, and be like, huh, I would never look at it at first. And now, because you have something to associate it with or someone, you're like, huh, I'm going to take a little bit more time. And hearing it, hearing why you're doing what you're doing, makes you appreciate a little bit more, you know. And anyone that's curious to ask them something, anyone that's curious to learn something from them, go for it. These are people, as we try to get every single episode, that you can talk to. Now, that doesn't mean bombard them with random questions and like, what's your social security number? But realistically, it's a comforting thing to see, man, that you both as a power team and as individuals are never afraid to push your bar and the bar to learn more.
Most definitely. And yeah, I'm honored to do this talk right now. You know, I'm still, it's shocking to me that anybody would care to hear what I have to say. Oh, so of course. I'm all for, if somebody wants to ask, I'm ready to, give, you know, a few words about it, because it's still unreal to me that people like my art, like what I have to say, any of that. So I'm grateful and always willing to share. If there's something that I can share, then I will do it. So yeah, aside from what's my social security number,
Oh, you can type that to me later. Anything that you want to cover before we wrap it up, my friend?
I don't know, man. I do want to say thanks. Like, I know this takes a lot of time from you, and I appreciate the opportunity and everything that you do for the community. So thank you.
Thank you, man.
I'm honored and happy to be a part of it, and I really appreciate everything you do, World of Pencils, for the exposure.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, no, man, I appreciate it. It's funny because when we sat down last time for a podcast, I had barely started doing this. Mm-hmm. And I remember how nervous I was to talk to you guys, because I was like, same premise you were talking about earlier. I felt like I wasn't as read up as you guys were. And I was like, all right, don't ask stupid questions. Don't ask stupid questions. And then we ended up having a great time. But it was the idea of like, you know, you taught me an exponential amount of knowledge when it came to how I look at a painting, how I approach a painting, and also as an artist, how I should just enjoy it. You know, that don't overthink things sometimes, because we all do it, but in the process of overthinking, sometimes we forget to enjoy it.
Right.
Where is your solo show going to be, my friend?
The show is going to be at Raison Gallery in the Hamptons, Jason's gallery. So
New York.
Thank you again to Jason and Kate for that opportunity. It's going to be September 9th. And I do hope to see people there. I will be there. It's going to have a lot of different things that I haven't really shown yet. So I'm excited that as it gets closer, I will be showing a little bit of what I'm working on. I'm also going to, I didn't talk about this, but I guess I'd like to throw it in.
Yeah,
I'm going to have some photography there, which I'm excited about. I haven't actually shown photography in a gallery setting yet. So it will be the first time that that takes place. And I'm really excited about how those have come out. I hope people are on board with that. So the back room of the gallery will be dedicated to my photography. And then the main area is going to be paintings, and with a few sculptures. So, I really hope to see people there, and, hope to get people talking about it and questioning things. I hope they see, Earth, you know, I hope they look at it and don't just see a rock. I hope they wonder why I took the time to paint it. And that would be because Earth deserves that recognition. It's been here before us. It will be here after us. And there needs to be a acknowledgement of it, I guess, in that it's kind of getting ruined right now. So if we can take the time to appreciate it and look at it for its beauty, then that's what I hope to get out of my show. So
nice. if anyone wants to contact you or find more of your work, do you have any website, anything, anything that you want to plug, plug away, plug, 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 plug.
My website is theartofoda.com. From there, you can use the contact page to email me or theartofoda@gmail.com. I'm always open to hear from everybody. If you have inquiries for work or just questions, I'm always open to it. So don't hesitate. And my Instagram is oda.paints. If you want to check out what events are coming up on the website, you can go to the CV exhibits page and you can see past and upcoming shows of where work can be seen. Yeah, aside from solos, there's always the ongoing group shows that myself and my wife are a part of. So you can see where you can find our work from there. And I guess that's it. Yeah.
September 9th, correct?
Yes.
September 9th in the Hamptons of New York. As if there's another one. But September 9th at Racing Gallery, we have Oda Paint's first solo show. Multimedia, medium, and I want anyone that's in the area or that is an advocate of going to shows and supporting artists in a physical aspect to please attend and please go, not only just for them, but for the Racing Gallery themselves. They are a great gallery to be around. And Oda, as always, man, it's good talking to you, a brother in matcha, and thank you for taking the time, man, and the beautiful work that you're doing. I hope to see a lot more of it. For anyone else that is wondering how you can find any of Oda's stuff, you are always welcome to look at Instagram, World of Pencils. You can go to store.worldofpencils.com. You can find them, or find us. I don't know which plural I use. But you can find World of Pencils at youtube.com/worldofpencils.com. Find it on iTunes, subscribe, and like, and all the other good jazz, hoopla, whatever you want to do. I'm not your dad. Do whatever you want. I don't care. Okay. Thank you so much, Oda. Have a great one, okay?
All right. Thank you.